safer route.
Mm-hmm.
I like the chew. I like a fatty piece of bacon.
I understand.
So what's your preferred?
Honestly, I'll just eat it. Whatever. I don't care that much.
I've asked you like 6 questions so far, and every answer has just been whatever's easiest. I don't want to be a problem. Whatever's closest, just give it to me. When we were talking at Square Root, you know, like 2 weeks ago or whatever, mm-hmm. when I was like, I wish I had the stuff with me right now. I wish we had recorded. Mm-hmm. That was such a great conversation. I'm so excited to have you here, by the way.
Thank you for having me.
Welcome, Angela Sawyer.
Yay.
To dinner at your place. I love talking to you just because you are a staple in Boston. Everyone in the scene knows you, loves you, respects you, looks up to you, all
Thank
that.
Thank you. That's very kind.
And you're good at comedy. And also, you're not intimidating to a... You're very open arms. Very, like, if you have a question or, like, sure. if you're feeling...
Why be a dick?
Exactly. So, I just am so happy to have you in this room right now in the chair. What are we eating? What are we having?
We're having French toast and bacon. It's awesome.
Goddamn we are. Goddamn right we are. Breakfast for dinner. And as I told you, my go-to is challah. I lived off challah bread French toast one summer mm-hmm. in college because mm-hmm. it's
well, this
$4.
Is amazing.
Yep. That's pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
You can't go wrong with French toast any time of the day. Oh, and it's so good to just sit here. So the other week when we were talking, you lost 80 pounds. You look wonderful. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And
I didn't eat all day so that I could have this. So I'm like,
that is another thing. We've had like people who've come over and have lost a ton of weight. They talk about this new diet. And then I'm like, here's a meal that contains probably about a half a stick of butter. I hope you're ready to have a cheat day. So I was asking you, you know, what is a favorite meal from your childhood? And you were like, I don't really have one. I had a weird, growing up.
I had
a
mom who didn't know how to cook.
Yeah, okay.
And
just you two?
No, my dad, well, most of the time. My dad
Let's get
ostensibly
into it.
lived there. But she was just, she's a reasonable lady for someone I don't like.
Sure, okay.
A lot
of fending for yourself.
She
then.
Didn't cook well. Mm. She made a chicken casserole.
Everyone's got that casserole, like fastball. You know, it's something, everyone had a casserole.
I think
casserole
that was just
that,
what was
yeah.
in magazines. Yep, I'm so old that, like... This was in the mid-70s, so, like, if you wanted to know how to be a housewife, you would just read a magazine. That's what... They had a lot of those ready for you.
Casserole.
To tell you what to do.
Casserole
casseroles
culture.
Were big.
Yep.
And her casseroles were so bad that my father, when he did come around, nicknamed them Cack and Farkas. And as a little kid, I didn't catch on that was, yeah. like, a... He was just being a sarcastic jerk, you know?
Cackenfarkus?
Yeah, that was what he called them.
Was it...
So I thought that was a dish, one.
Okay, yeah.
And two, he clearly didn't like it. So I was afraid to eat it.
Afraid to eat as a kid. That's a good place to start with food.
So we had a big blowout several times because he was like, Cack and Farkas is on deck. And I was like, no, even though I had no idea what that meant.
Did you ever learn what Cack and Farkas, why he called it that?
I have no idea. He was, nope. Like most things about my parents, I did not learn a thing. We were a very dysfunctional family. So,
are you?
That things like that counted as like interaction.
He talked to me. I didn't understand it, but
yeah.
He's here and he said something.
This guy said something.
What happened here? Oh, Siri. I hate when Siri does this. Let me pour this cup of coffee for you. I think it's insane,
Thank you.
By the way, that you're drinking coffee.
Sorry, coffee is something I like a lot right now.
Yeah, so when you said to the, French toast, bacon, coffee...
Mm-hmm.
My first question, and I
Thank
felt
you.
You don't want like cream or anything, or
I'll take it if you have it.
Yeah, we do. Hold on one second. So yeah, when you said coffee, I had the. I asked you. I was like, "Did you drink that as a kid?" And the
God no.
And I in my brain, I was like, "No, that came off as if you're like, you can't have it if you didn't drink it as a kid." But no, I just asked because the vision of you as like an 8-year old with this stressful like parent situation in this house of just like, I need my Joe. This is the only way I can get by.
The thing you need to know about me, the vision of me as a kid, is that I was roughly shaped like a tomato. I'm
cream or almond milk?
Oh, almond milk. Holy shit. What a swanky affair this is. Yeah, that was the color and texture of me as a person when I was an 8-year old. I was a very weird kid. Did not fit in well. Looked like a tomato most of the time.
You were the always sunburned kid.
Yeah, I really was. I have a very some people are like, "Oh, you have such an olive complexion." I don't.
Are you Mediterranean? No, I'm just sort of burned all the time.
Yeah. Nobody knows exactly. My family is messed up enough that I don't actually know what my parents' technical ethnicity was.
You don't know where you hail from?
I don't know that.
You never spit in a tube? You don't want to?
Nah. What am I going to find? 17 kinds of white? Why do I need that information?
I mean, you technically don't if it is just going to be 17 kinds of white, but there could be the, 2%.
Yeah, that's still 17 kinds of white. I know who Elizabeth Warren is. That's still 17 kinds of white.
Yeah, and then you start pulling that out and everyone's going to be like, shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
So, didn't fit in. We talked about how, now I'm remembering a little bit where you were telling me at Square Root similarly, like, didn't fit in, kind of a weird kid, weird home situation. And I was like, oh, man, food can be such a, a comforting thing.
Mm.
It's like a great friend, I bet. Like, was that, how did you feel? And immediately you just looked at me and you're like, Danny, I just lost 80 pounds. And I was like, dumb question. Food was a great friend for you. It was probably the best friend.
It was a good coping mechanism. I think the TV was my best friend when I was a kid.
And combining the two, that's still my favorite thing is after a hard cut, like however long, couple, whatever, if I have a night, ordering Chinese food, plopping down in that chair and watching a basketball game is my favorite thing in the world to do. Mm-hmm. That's what I do for Christmas days now.
Oh, like, nice.
I'm done with the stressful stuff of it. Like, my sister and I, we go to the Knicks game.
Yeah.
And then after that, I'm watching basketball. And if we're not at the Knicks game, I'm doing basketball all day with $80 worth of Chinese food for one person.
Right.
That lasts 3 days. And they bring, they bring.
I know those orders well.
They bring six forks and you're like, no. I've got this.
Yeah. I won't need that.
Yeah. What's the most you can remember spending on a takeout order that made you think like, oh geez, have you reached triple digits?
Maybe not. I've easily in the last 5 years spent $65 on takeout.
Yeah.
That's easy to do.
It's real easy.
Have I ever hit triple digits? I don't know if I have.
I think the Christmas basketball 85 was my, I think with then, tip, delivery, all like
it's
that's
not that I
when
wouldn't.
It came out to 100. Yeah. Once you see the you come to the number that you're okay with.
Right. That's the thing. I think honestly, the thing that keeps me from getting the triple digits is that I'm also cheap. So it's like my two worst qualities fight it out. And then I'm like, well, I can do this.
So did you just lean into the cheapness then to lose the weight?
Honestly, I just weaponized laziness. Yeah, totally. Absolutely. I was like, okay.
Weaponized laziness.
If I subscribe to a food service, that means I never have to cook anything because I'm also very bad at it.
Well, you didn't learn. Where were you going to learn it from?
I had a Disney book as a kid that taught you how to bake a cake. That's the only cooking lessons I've ever had.
Is that cake recipe and just drilled into your brain too?
Well, I got halfway through and then ate the raw cake dough and made myself ill. So I unsuccessful.
In my head, this book was like, you would read it before bed every night and be like, good night, mom. I mean, book. Sorry. That's what I'm about. Good night, book. Mm-hmm. So it's just like this cake recipe is the one thing you know how to make. It's so close to your heart. And instead, no, you got halfway through and made yourself sick.
Yeah. I didn't even finish it. Yeah. So no recipes are in my brain.
Yeah. Again, like, you had no structure to say, like, yeah. Put the eggs here, then do this, then do that. So you had to figure it out on your own from this book.
Honestly, as an adult, occasionally I would get roped into a situation where you had to make something. Mm-hmm. Or like, you know, your boss invited you to a potluck or like something where you can't go to the store and buy it.
Yeah.
And in those situations, I would have to spend, that's where I would easily hit triple digits, because I would have to like go to the store and buy pots and pans and buy silverware and buy dishes and buy like spoons. And
you
then
just showed up with half a baked cake.
And then like read.
Here's dough for everyone.
And then I wouldn't be able to read the recipe. So I learned in my 20s to Google recipes for children, because those I could read.
Wow. So, and like, instead of like teaspoons, what does the children's recipe say versus
like children's recipe will be like, get this spoon that says 1/4. And I'd be like, okay, I got that. You know, whereas the adult recipe will say whisk. And then I'm like, what does that mean?
Sliced spoon.
Yeah. I'm just like, what? And, you know, and the adult recipe won't tell you how long to do something or like what it's supposed to look like when you're done or anything. And I screw up because I don't know what it, like, I have no vibe for it.
Like, oh my God, does this look right? Like, does this smell
right?
I
have no idea. Over the pandemic, I tried to get better at cooking. And my goal was to get to the level of like a freshman boy.
In high school or college?
College. So I set my sights high. I did not make it. I did not succeed. I did have an experience where I would like, I would try something and then I would show it to my roommate Shakir and be like, do you think this is food? and a lot of times he would be like, no.
What was the like freshman boy? What was the first thing you were like, this is what a freshman boy makes? What'd you try to present?
Grilled cheese. Okay. I tried a grilled cheese and I eventually made a couple of grilled cheeses that were edible. And I even, the height of my powers was I managed to make a fried egg. And I was like very impressed with myself. I did not succeed at rice.
Rice is so hard.
That's what people keep telling me. They're like, rice is hard.
Yeah.
I tried grits from the box.
Dude.
Did not succeed.
I can't fuck around with
grits. I was
like,
it comes in a box. Yeah. That couldn't be that. Nope. Not at all. Rice? Did not make something edible. I made a couch, basically.
My mom, when I went to college, made a little recipe book. You know, she wrote out
very sweet.
Of a bunch of stuff that I ate, you know, growing up, loved, you know, all that.
It's like the proto version of this podcast.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. And we talked about it a little bit. She was a guest and she did radio in college. It's like a very full circle.
I love her.
She's the best. So in the recipe book though, she wrote out how to cook rice.
See?
It's like three steps. And there's a note that's like, this is hard. Like, don't think that rice is one of the easier things. It's like a weird finesse. Timing. It's such a strange, strange thing that you look at. It's like in everything, in so many cultures, a rice dish is so prevalent.
Right. It's very standard.
And then you try it all. It's like, yo, a freshman boy could cook rice. No. Mm-mm. Pots burned, ruined. See ya. Fire alarms getting set off.
The best rice that I made was when I forgot to turn on the burner. So I just soaked some rice in cold water for like an hour and then I heated it up and that worked.
Innovation. Innovation meets hunger is rice for Angela. The grilled cheese, just butter. There's so much soft butter.
Yeah.
Cover that bread.
Yeah. Somebody told me to try mayonnaise, and I don't think I ever managed to try it. Both my roommates are like vegetarian and vegan, so I'm not going to bring mayonnaise.
I've heard the mayo thing too, and I don't. Mayo is.
I get it.
It's too goopy.
My stepmother made a chocolate cake that had mayo in it, and it was great.
Really?
Yeah, it was very good.
Well, okay, so there's... When you hear... What do you think of cream cheese frosting? Like, when that
comes... Sounds fun.
See, to me, though, it does sound weird, and then you have it, it's in, like, carrot cake, it's, you know, it's in a bunch of stuff. It's good then, but some food, like, the names of foods just don't make sense to me.
I think I have so little, like... I can't see in, like, I can't put my hand in the puppet. I can't see in to the consequences of food so badly that, like, you could tell me, you know, like, yeah, we're just going to cut up a block of cheese and leave it outside for 3 weeks, and then we're going to put it in this thing and then stir some mayonnaise, and I'd be like, okay.
See, that's also, though, you're a blank canvas, though, because if you do get into, like, trying to get better than just a freshman boy or, like, whatever, you could just be... You could find the new best flavor in the world because you're so gung-ho. You'd be like, yeah, peanut butter and mayo. Turns out, who knew?
Right.
You get this nice, creamy, it's like a little sour, it's thick.
I can think outside the box for sure.
Did you ever do like a weird, when you were on those sad kid nights, those lonely kid nights? What was the, you know, did you ever combine like a weird snack?
My self-made kid snack was what I called a bologna sandwich, which is, it's so disgusting. You take a single slice of Wonder Bread.
Okay, this is a good start.
Put a slice of bologna on it.
It's fine.
You put it on a paper towel. You put it in the microwave.
Oh, this is where you lose.
You put it in the microwave, and it turns into a disgusting mess. And then you pick it up with your hand and smoosh it into a ball. I just want to see your face.
You turn it into a softball?
Yeah, yeah. You just said, turn it into a ball, and then you eat it.
Oh, it's just a little energy ball. It's just
it's very gross because the bologna, like, if you put it in the microwave, a bunch of liquid comes out of it.
Yeah, of course
it's
does.
It's nasty.
Yeah.
And that soaks all into your bread, and it just turns into this gross mess.
This might be the first time someone's gotten me to gag. That might be the first
it's
gag.
Very nasty.
Oh my god! And I tried tuna casserole, which has been an enemy of my whole life. I tried it. This might be the first gag.
Wow!
Congratulations.
Wow. Sorry.
For a fistful of bologna.
Yeah, that's. I like
I
said.
Crying from laughing.
Like I said, oh. I don't have those skills.
I mean. And no one, I was going to say, and no one said like, hey, that's not food, pal.
No one noticed that I was eating that. I was very, like, the nicest thing that my parents did, honestly, is left me alone a lot. But from the time that I was like 5 or 6 years old, they would leave me alone for a couple hours at a shot.
5 or 6?
Yeah. And by the time I was 8 or 9... During the summer vacation, I was by myself in the house all day, every day.
Just like ultimate latchkey kid.
We were just roommates, basically.
Wow.
So, and that was the nice thing. Like, people are like, oh, that's neglectful. And they're right, but that was nice.
That's kind of what I was getting
at. Like, being around
them
was much worse. So, like, I was very happy to have that. And like I said, the TV was my best friend. I watched TV like a crazy person when I was a kid.
What was the show?
It was all the shows.
All the
I watched
shows
TV from like 5:30 in the morning until 9 o'clock at night every day.
Wow.
I watched TV.
I mean, those are the friendly voices.
Yeah.
If the people.
I distinctly remember when I was a kid hearing the sound of the applause on The Tonight Show and having. Like, when I was having a bad time when I was a teenager, and I was, like, super, you know, having an existential crisis, you know, you're 15, you want to die every day.
As teenagers do.
Yeah,
also
as we do.
Maybe a little more warranted for the situation you found yourself in.
Everybody has a bad situation some of the time. So, yeah. I remember hearing that sound, and when you hear it when you're having a really hard time, that sound is so, it's very far away. And it's very, it just seems like it's coming from another planet. Like, you can't imagine a planet where people are, like, laughing at jokes, wow. Laughing at the news.
Yeah.
And you hate it. You're
yeah,
angry
you're
at
angry
them.
At.
And I remember thinking, if I ever get to a point in my life where that sound sounds good, I'll have made it. Like, that's what I want. That's my goal. And now I do comedy and I make people make that sound. And so I made it. I did great.
That made me so happy. Because I was just, how did you, like, when did that turn come then from, like.
Oh, it took a long time. I'm very old.
When did you start doing stand-up, too? You've been doing it for, what, at least 10 years now,
I've been doing it about 10 years. I started when I was 42.
That's cool. That's also really cool because normally people...
And sad.
No, normally people are like, oh, you got to start 19, 18, 20.
Right,
like,
right, right.
Everyone's so obsessed about, like, when you started. It's funny. Yes. No one cares. No one cares how old you are. Everyone cares when you started.
Yeah, right. So I started when I was 42, and... you've been to open mics, so you know that generally people who are over 30 and like start, show up at the mic, go up for the first time, people expect bad things from those people.
So
and
it can be a little strange.
And you get them. They deliver. They do deliver those bad things. It's usually racist, and they deliver some real humdingers.
Well, let's not say that that's just an over 30 trait. That's an open mic trait.
That's an open micer trait for sure. But like, there's a stereotype of the older, new comic that is like, I feel that a lot because I'm older, because I'm the only one over
50. Sure, so you're trying to avoid that.
Right. So I feel that when I get on stage. Yeah. But honestly, comedy is definitely like, a thing that it's not that, for the thing that I did from when I was 20 till I was, which I still do, is play experimental music. And they're not that different. Except experimental music is something no one likes or usually has heard of.
Do people like comedy?
They way more, way more, so much more. Yes.
Experimental, that's to me. When you say experimental music, and I was going to be like, what is that? And if you were just be like, I experiment. To me, that's also me being like, oh, you have a fresh palate. You don't know taste combos. You can just, you can do experimental music in the kitchen.
You can.
Yeah.
You absolutely can. It's the best way to explain experimental jazz is, the Jackson Pollock painting. Yeah, it's like that, but sound.
Oh, okay, just like splattering.
So it's just about like the novelty of texture, and it doesn't it doesn't have rhythm necessarily, yeah. And no one has to like it. I'm very aware that I like it, and like four people in this town like it, and nobody else does, and that's fine.
Yeah, but then so when you meet one of those four people, is that like an instant friendship though?
Sometimes, sometimes.
Or is it the open mic over 30? You're like, oh no, you're fucking weird.
That's the world that I lived in that was like the open mic community for a long time. That was my Island of Misfit Toys that I went to when I was 20. And I still know all those people and like them. And that's what I just got back from Chicago and I went there.
Yeah.
An experimental music place in Chicago flew me out to play a show there. That's why I went.
Oh, that's awesome.
And I just put up the video today. I'm excited.
Oh,
it came out really nicely.
I gotta watch that after this now. What do you, what instrument do you play?
So, I basically play a table full of garbage. I play a mixer. I'll tell you, but it's because we're on a podcast. Otherwise, I would just be like, don't even worry about it.
I mean, I would be curious even if we were not on it.
It's a mixer that's plugged back into itself rather than plugged into speakers. And then you plug it into speakers, so it feeds back. It makes like the sound of a motorcycle starting. It goes...
Oh, wow. Okay.
And then if you turn the knob too much, it'll go...
Oh, wow. Okay.
And then I put that through tremolo pedals that are hard panned. I have two of them. So... That makes it, when you do that, that makes it, if you put two speakers out, you have stereo speakers, it'll make the sound pop back and forth between the two stereo speakers.
Oh, cool, okay.
So you get this like, and it goes pop, 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 pop. Pop. And then I also play hunting calls. So people who shoot animals, they want to make the sound that attracts the animal that they want to shoot. And depending on the animal, that's either an injured animal or an animal that wants to have sex. And so they make all these plastic toys that make those sounds, and I play those.
How? Okay.
So it's like pop, pop, pop.
I was going to say injured animal versus wanting to have sex animal. How similar are the
Real
sounds?
Similar.
They're I can't imagine. I can imagine it's a similar pitch.
Very similar. I can't tell them apart.
So did you get into like, I mean, it's clear that's so much more involved than just like, I'm going to pick up a guitar and diddle my way through.
Right. So like, that's what I learned. Like, that's my cooking, basically. That's where I learned taste and learned how to like.
Interesting.
You know, and I was like, oh, a tiny dash of this rosemary makes it do this, you know.
Oh, a tiny dash of this rosemary makes the goose come.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Exactly. And sometimes you want the goose to run away.
Is that your high school outlet then?
I didn't have an outlet in high school. I didn't find it until, I was grounded from the TV all through high school. I was grounded from everything in high school. I was a weirdo in high school.
How do they ground you from stuff if they didn't let you
well, that's
do
why
shit or teach you how to...
fucked up.
Yeah, okay, my bad. That's, yeah, that's a bad, yeah.
The answer to that question is why I'm like this.
Well, incredibly well adjusted then for
Thank
it
you.
Seems like you've done a lot of the work to be like, that's on them.
I think a lot of it is, I mean, I had a really hard time in high school and I got down to a place where I was close to needing to be institutionalized, you know, I was very fucked up.
Yeah.
And having made it through that and I like got lucky and survived and like moved away and stuff. So I feel like once you go through things like that, it's the same thing that everybody who's ever had a trauma has a response. Like you survive and then you're like, oh, you can't hurt me.
I'm invincible.
And then and then you live and you're like, oh, you can.
The other things hurt too.
And then you have to, like, figure that out. But for me, records were a way of connecting to people and learning how to play music and cooking. But also, they were, you know, a good record. I'm sure, I don't know if this is true, but I would guess that a great recipe is like a pair of glasses that have a particular tint on them. Mm-hmm. And you can look through anything at the world with them. And a great meal is like the reward, and also you can reverse engineer it to get the recipe, you know? And what? Records are like that. A great record, you can like do a detective project and follow the clues and reverse engineer it and figure out the perspective of the person who made it. And then you can look at whatever you want with that perspective. And I basically did that to learn how to be a person. That's how I learned.
the records became
I was
your
like,
parents. And
this
your...
guy, Brian Wilson from the Beach Boys, knows how to live. And in some cases, I was wrong, but still, well, I learned.
He knows how to live. Oh, he shouldn't have been living with those young women. That part's bad. Doesn't that part suck when you find a musician you love? Like, there's the, you know, my Sky Dog book right there, the story of Dwayne Allman.
Mm-hmm.
And there was, you know, I was loving every second of this book. And then there was one story about how they had a little studio in, I think, Alabama. And the guy who is a record producer was talking about it was like, I didn't hang out there a lot. They were drinking, doing drugs, and they had young women there. I mean, young.
For a Nashville studio person to say that is damning.
That's
difficult.
To specify again, hammer it home. I was like, oh no, this one.
Yeah,
really
that's bad.
Sad.
That's a child.
Yeah, I was like, oh, mate, they were 19 too, maybe. Oh,
no, they weren't.
No, they were
definitely 12.
Oh. I meant the guys were 19.
Oh,
and they,
that's yeah,
totally. It was
yeah, that's bad.
It was so sad, and I, you know, still got the peach.
Right. Yeah, that's the thing. Well, that's the good thing about the whole glasses metaphor that I was talking about earlier is that you get to see what you want. So you don't have to...
You can clean the glasses, too.
That's right.
In your own way.
That's right. You can be like, oh, not that part.
I'll buff that part out and not view the world through your lens, how you did that 12-year-old girls are cool. That part's not great, Brian Wilson or Dwayne Allman.
You can fix your heroes a little. Not all the way, but a little.
Yeah, isn't that such a...
They're all bad eventually. That's the thing, I think. They all fall down at some point. That's how heroes work.
Yeah, and it's just how hard they fall, I guess.
Yeah. There's different sometimes it's real.
I was going to say, there's different versions of falling.
That's true.
You know, the Alabama hanging out with who you're hanging out with and making music. I don't want to gloss over that. that's a.
Yeah.
That's not cool, Dwayne.
Yeah, let's pick that out with a set of tweezers and get it out of here. Yeah,
exactly. Oh, man. The record store is such like a fun, I lost all my records. I don't know. It's such a sad thing, but like, it's a cool place to just get lost in for an hour and flip through and be like, oh, this is a weird.
I always felt like records were I don't know if it's still as true as it used to be, but when I started collecting records, they were just all around, you know? And you could just go into a bunch of rooms around town where there were thousands upon thousands upon thousands of them. You know, like one room has 100,000 records, the next room has 50,000. And when there's that many in a room, it's not curated for you. You have to interpret what you're seeing. What you're seeing is just raw dump of old stuff. And so you have to figure out, like, what does this mean? Is this okay? You know? And like, I don't know, I talk a lot to, when I talk to people who know about experimental music, I'm always like, you guys are racist.
is that in the experimental music world?
It's in the record collector world, for sure. It's a racist, really? Sexist world. It's, I mean, so is comedy.
Well, I knew that because I'm in that world.
Yeah. It's the same. They all, like, it's the world. So, like, it has all the bad things.
Yeah.
But one of the nice things about collecting records is that it teaches you some amount of critical thinking, because you have to figure out what is worth having and what isn't worth having. And that process of learning, like, what is worth it, what isn't worth it, little by little, if you do that enough, you define, just by like being like, no to this, yes to this, no to this, yes to this, you define by, you put together a circle of dots, you know, you put together a set of dots that turn into a circle that teaches you what beautiful stuff is, what good stuff is. And, you know, you get to talk to the other people who have their own ideas, and some of them have great ideas, and some of them have terrible ideas.
Some of them have racist ideas.
Yeah, some of them have real fucked up ideas also. But you know, you get to find out.
Yeah.
And the stuff is just there without anybody cleaning it up for you. Nobody's fixed it for you. Nobody's put it into an order. It's just around. And so you can really, it's like a cool way of doing, you can do a little, you know, social anthropology, you can do a little history, you can do a little, you know, and you learn. It's aesthetics. You figure it out.
It's just a rabbit hole.
It's a rabbit hole. It's a giant rabbit hole, much like comedy. And yeah, and you can live, you can go as far down that rabbit hole as you want.
And it seems like with the experimental music, like, are you trying to like connect those tunnels of the rabbit holes?
Well, I think once you get involved in that stuff, you think of it as your, like, it all seemed like one rabbit hole to me.
Okay.
Like, when I was in my 20s, I was very interested in taking away whatever fences I might have in my head about art stuff, like, so that I wouldn't have any, you know, so that I could appreciate stuff on its own terms, just appreciate whether or not it met its goals, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And figure out stuff that was hard to figure out. And so a lot of my favorite pieces of music or pieces of art or pieces of comedy are pieces that when you first encounter them, you're like, what the fuck is going on here? You know, where you just cannot figure it out and makes no sense. And you're like, but I can tell that someone thought it made sense. What were they thinking?
And you know? Something there grabs you and you're like, I gotta figure this out.
Yeah, and that's a big factor for me and stuff. A lot of the stuff that I like and have, you know, have liked for a long time has that aspect
so
to it.
So it kind of seems like 20s is where you now came online.
A little bit, yeah.
Like I up was until a, then, yeah, you were just kind of like existing because you had to and were told to.
I was a very angry kid, I think.
Did you just have to wipe the slate clean at 20 or whatever age it was and say, like, I gotta do
maybe,
this my
in some
way.
Ways. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, I moved out of the house when I was 17, and it was mutual, but, like, no one helped me. I literally just, like, I came home one afternoon, and my stepmother had found that I was, like, taking stuff to the school so that I could move out.
Okay.
You know, and, like, hiding it so that I would be able to move out later. So she kicked me out on the spot. And so I went to stay with a friend, and I stayed at the debate teacher's house for a few months, and I got my first apartment with her help when I was, like, 18.
That's awesome.
And I had some really bad apartments, you know, but I, like, figured it out.
What,
and I,
what 18 to 20 year old to right. you know what you know
yeah that's not does, a good apartment
yeah, yeah exactly yeah.
And then I wanted to go to school because I liked school, because school for me, not everybody likes school, but school for me was the place that made sense when I was a kid.
It was
an you know?
Escape
school yeah it's, school yeah. was a place where, like, they told you what was going to happen and then it happened and I was like, ooh, fancy, you know.
Expectations.
I was like, wow.
Yeah. Structure.
And then if people would tell you what to do, and then if you did it, they were like, great job. And I was like, oh, wow. You know, so I loved school. And so I was like, I want to go to college. Sure. And I had a sense that New England was a place where people were also angry. And that's hard to explain. Like, when you're a kid, you just kind of think things about places without really knowing why you think that.
Yeah.
But I turned out to be right. I came here and I felt at home for
you
the first
on,
time.
You nailed that shit on the button.
Yeah, I was dead right.
This is an angry place. That's
and
what
I was like, oh, this feels great.
That's what I told my dad. You know, when I lived here for 2, 3, 4 weeks, something like that. He came down. We had breakfast. He goes, "How's it going, buddy?" And I said, "It's okay. It's you know that feeling when you give someone a hug and they don't hug you back? That's Boston. That's that feeling where your arms are wrapped around someone, theirs are at their side, just like, don't touch me.
Yeah.
I don't want this."
Yeah. I remember the joy. For me, it was a great joy coming to Boston and walking down the street and having a stranger pass me in the opposite direction and not even look at me. Not smile, not acknowledge, nothing. And I was like,
"You're from a small town where everyone..."
I was from Denver. It's polite.
Sure.
Denver's a nice place. And there, you know, it's the suburbs. Like, everyone you see, everyone says hello. Yeah. And I loved it. I was like, you could just... Boston, to me, still is the town where, like, you could see your best friend, ignore them, and no problem. And I was like, yeah! What a great place!
Just give him a head nod and be like, "I'll see you around."
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you don't even have to do that. Nobody's going to get mad. They're just going to be like, whatever, he was in his thing. You know?
Man, so the Denver stroked, you know, to here to, like, at what, 17, you said?
I moved to here when I was 20 in 1990.
That's still, like, again, though, just young of, like, I'm wiping this slate. Like, mm-hmm. Whatever's happened has happened. I'm taking control and doing... what I want
to
do
now. I felt like I wanted to go to a place where, you know, I was interested in getting to a place where the Johnny Carson laughs were laughs. And I didn't know how to make that happen, but I knew I wanted to be far from where I was. So I got as far as I could without crossing the ocean, and I found an angry place.
Without
and I was like,
a passport.
Jackpot.
Where can I be pissed off?
Yeah. Yeah, Boston's a great city for that. It's also full of schools, and I like school, and I went to school for philosophy, and that's something that went very nicely here, you know. So it suited me very well, and I've always felt at home here.
Philosophy, I feel like, too, is a good... I only took, like, you know, I was an English major,
it's close.
I was literally about to say, it's a slight right-hand turn.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
away.
I agree.
It is
The way I found what... I didn't find out that what I liked was called philosophy until I got to college. I thought it was called people who read Ernest Hemingway. And then I got to college and I took an intro class and I was like, oh, it's a whole thing.
I liked most about that stuff too. It's funny, what you liked about school was what drove me away from it, was the rigid, you know, answers of like a science or a math. It's like the formula is the formula.
Yeah.
You have to find
right.
the answer with the formula. And that just put too much pressure on me. I feel like I was like, oh, fuck, I don't know the formula, even sure. though I studied it for 2 weeks.
Right.
Versus English, where I was like, oh, you read Ernest Hemingway? I didn't like Ernest Hemingway. Let's argue about it, and great. We could both be right.
Yes,
you know?
We could. Yes, that's we could.
I mean, I loved Ernest. That was just an example.
But no, like, I understand.
That's exact. It's like, answer. It's just all up. It's a fugazi. It's all up to interpretation.
Yeah. As long as you make an argument that holds, you know, yeah. that has its own internal clockwork or whatever, yeah. then great. You got it. You
I
did it.
I wish I didn't have to spend so much of my parents' money to learn that's what I liked.
Sure. I mean, I spent money that no one had. So I getcha. I'm a hot watch. All my phone is like full of every news article about student loans.
Yeah, well, it's such a little like hook that they keep dragging along of like, yanked it from you. Not yeah. this time, bitch. Like,
it's so evil.
And also, like, what if you just don't?
I mean, I haven't.
And what's you know? Happened?
Nothing so far.
That's, yeah. What,
you know?
And
so
that
far,
was,
nothing.
What, 20 years ago?
Oh, more than 25.
Yeah. So.
Forever.
Fuck them.
Yeah.
Isn't that
it's garbage.
It's all just made up.
It is made up. For sure. I recommend not ever paying for college.
Yeah.
Heavily. It's bullshit.
Endorse that for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. I have one final one, and this is what I've been ending with every time so far.
This has been so nice. You asked me such nice questions.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that. This one's not nice.
Okay.
No legal or societal consequences.
Okay.
What animal would you want to eat?
No, I don't know. I mean, there's no consequences.
Yeah, no one's gonna, you know, no judgment. No one's gonna say
right.
that's wrong. You can't have that animal. Because that's like such an interesting thing, right?
Is yeah.
why can we eat? Why
some
is,
of
why
them
is
and
the,
not others
why
of
is
them?
The cow okay?
Right.
But, you know, a dog is,
I mean, that's just
vile versus,
it's just tradition.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with reality. It's
right,
just
exactly.
Like,
which is why
it's
then,
just where the cows were a long time ago.
Exactly. Which is why then in this room there we suspend the reality.
Sure.
And say which animal that you have not eaten, because people are like, naughty, naughty. Where are you going with?
I mean, per our conversation, the answer has to be mom. But of course, I'm not going to do that.
No one has said human yet. And
I don't really want to do that. But like,
it's a power move.
But like, that's what our conversation is pointing to. So like, that's the correct answer for this moment. But I don't know. I don't. Like, I eat meat. I don't have a big issue about it. But I'm not,
yeah.
like, I'm not, like, there's not a list of things that I want to eat that people aren't eating.
Okay, so let me.
The list of things I want to eat is food that people are eating.
That's, again, as you haven't.
I'm a consistent person.
Whatever you put in front of me, I'll eat it. Are you eating this? I'll eat it too. Fuck it. So again, for me, from the start, have always said giraffe. I don't know why.
Okay.
Giraffe seems very interesting to me.
Yeah.
There's been horse, hippo.
Uh-huh.
Someone did say dog, finally.
Okay.
So
what do you think is different about, like, is it, do you feel like there's a, like a flavor profile that you
yeah.
would get from the giraffe
from the
that you
absolutely.
Cannot get.
I don't know why. I just think based on its size,
yeah.
there's no other, what What else is a giraffe?
Do you think... Let me ask you this.
What's a giraffe, Angela?
I don't know. But this is very interesting to me. So do you think that you could, like... For somebody who has an excellent palate, such as yourself, which I do not have, do you think that people can tell by taste and be like, oh, this animal is this large, this animal is this geography, this can you figure that out from the taste?
I think...
Do you think it's consistent enough?
You can definitely tell the, like, leanness of an animal through the taste of it. If, you know, you can definitely taste if something's really fatty. Or if something is, like, more muscular and tough.
Right.
And that's why I'm intrigued by the giraffe, because I feel like there's pockets on that animal that have both.
Yeah.
It is, it's a very lean creature at points, but yeah. then also it has, like, a nice little pouch on its belly. Sure. It's a little chubby. But, like, the neck has to be so... Like,
strong.
Right. What does that neck taste like?
Okay.
You know, that's what... Okay. It to me, it seems like it would be a... Like a variation of a filet mignon medallion.
I don't know what that is, but okay.
it's a type of steak.
I'll say this. Let me tell you this. When I picture the giraffe steak, I picture it with spots. And I bet you don't.
I do not. You are correct about that. And I was just going to say, too, I bet you could end up eating human and someone could just be like, yes, this is a steak, Angela.
Yeah, I wouldn't know.
This is a cow. And you'd be like, cow's great. I love this. And meanwhile, you are eating your mom.
Yeah. You could feed me a lot of things and I'd just be like, seems fine. Yeah, I have a very undeveloped palate.
Yeah,
it's very much a child's palate.
And the list of things that you asked for, too, this was very fun. You said it was hot dogs and mac, which is...
You asked me, what did you want as a child? And that's... I remember declaring to God knows who that I would eat hot dogs all the time once I grew up.
I did the same thing as
a child. Yeah, I think hot most dogs, children do. Right. Hot dogs were genius.
Absolutely.
And I remember loving Kraft mac and cheese.
Kraft is great.
And then I remember having it as an adult and being like, oh, this isn't as good as I thought it was. And being very confused by that.
That's where we differ, because as an adult now, I'm like, you were right.
Oh, yeah.
You were right, Danny. Nice. This was, you nailed
I
this one.
I probably made
as
it badly. It's very possible that I made it wrong.
Hot dogs and mac, and then you said, or just a bowl of cereal.
Bowl of cereal was what I wanted most when I was a kid, because I wasn't allowed to have sugary cereals.
Mm.
And so as soon as I started buying my own food... Oh, there were rules, sure. As soon as I was allowed to buy my own food, I was like, Captain Crunch, man. And I love sugary cereals. And I don't eat them much these days, but sure.
Captain
sugary
Crunch.
Cereals are a huge treat. Yeah.
I was going to ask, is what's your go-to then? And is it Cap'n Crunch?
It's peanut butter Cap'n Crunch.
Peanut butter Cap'n Crunch.
I love peanut butter Cap'n Crunch.
Yummy. I got the Oops All Berries one.
Oh, yeah. They didn't invent that until I was like 40.
Yeah. Have you tried them?
Yeah. It's good.
Yeah. How were, what color were your BMs at? Was it like a weird...
Oh, blue.
Yeah.
Yeah. It'll turn your poop blue. Yeah. Not many foods do that.
I was really concerned for like...
I know what you mean.
For like 5 minutes, 10 minutes. I was like... Am I dying?
That, the first time that happens to you, you're like, what the fuck is going on with me?
Oh,
and then
wait,
you're like,
Captain
oh,
Crunch.
Wait, I ate a blue food.
Oh, I had half a box of blue cereal.
Yeah. Yeah.
I haven't tried. So once I had the scary moment of, oh, God, you're going to have poop Lou Gehrig's disease from Cap'n Crunch, just stick with your normal Cap'n Crunch. I don't fuck around with the peanut butter one.
Peanut butter one, but it's an acquired taste, I think. Honestly.
Now I'm intrigued.
It doesn't have the, like, you know, regular Captain Crunch, one, it cuts up your mouth, which is
its own.
Like, there's nothing, this is what they say about Skinner, the psychologist, invented this idea with the Pavlovian dogs and stuff. Like, there's nothing that makes you fall in love like inconsistency. We all know this, right? Captain Crunch cuts up your mouth and gives you intense sugar, and it's perfectly inconsistent. It's a bad parent all the way around, and everyone loves it. Nobody can not love it.
You know how, like, dip chewing tobacco? They have, the fiberglass and the nicotine cut.
Right,
like,
sure.
It cuts your lip open. That's not... Captain Crunch is thing. Just, it's the dip for kids.
Yes, absolutely.
It cuts the roof of your mouth up, and then that sugar just gets in there, and then you are on cloud nine.
Yeah. It makes you feel good. It makes you so happy.
It makes you relaxed. God. You pack an upper.
Oh, I've done that.
Totally. I need my Captain Crunch.
Yeah, I'm from Colorado. They do that there.
Yeah. Oh, have you
I've never done it, but my stepbrother, when I was a teenager, built a pyramid of Kodiak cans in the basement. It was like as long as the basement wall.
That is garbage.
Yeah. Yep. We've all been to garbage town.
I love you so much. You are
this
such
was so
a good
fun
friend.
Thank you so much.
Of course. I want to make you steaks now. I want to like make you good food. Sure. That's not French toast.
Oh,
because
this was
you
so
deserve
fun.
It
I loved it. I loved your French toast. It was great. You made good bacon, you made great French toast, and having said all the things I've said, you're like some compliment, but
stop it.
But
no.
Honestly, fantastic.
Thank you.
This guy poured me coffee in front of my face. How many men have done that? Come on.
Enough. Stop it. Square root is it bi-week? Is it every other?
It's every other. It's the first, third, and then the fifth that the error is one, which is so messy.
First, third, and fifth. If there is one Thursday of the month at the Square Root in Roslindale.
Yes. Before the pandemic, I ran 4 monthlies and 2 weeklies. And now I just have 1 semi-regular. And that's what the pandemic is.
Yeah, it was
that's
a changing
the thing that
landscape.
Didn't go away.
Yeah. But it's a great... I love that room so much.
That room's great.
It's really
very
fun.
I get down on it because I'm very aware of where I stop having things in common with the audience that goes there. And they're not totally my people. They want to be, but they're not.
But that's cool then, because then...
And they're nice.
If you have something that hits, you know it
I know
hits,
it's...
Though.
Yeah,
because
exactly.
Because if you're like,
they're
oh,
very
if it's hitting with these
that.
People
they're very
who
good
are
for
not
that.
My
they're
people.
My TV audience. Yeah, for sure. For sure.
I will put your... Instagram handle as well. I'm so bad at remembering them, but I know this one because I love it. Down with pants.
Yep, but no H.
But no, down with pants, yes.
Yes.
Just genuine, just don't like pants?
It's a button that I had when I was younger. I had a button that said down with pants on it. I thought it was a funny button. Just recently when I went to Chicago, I went to the Button Museum. It was awesome.
Well, now hold on just a minute. The Button Museum.
Yeah, there's a Button Museum.
What?
Not like close your clothes buttons, like a pin button museum.
Oh, okay.
In Chicago. And they have tons of great like political buttons from that are older and stuff, but also there's a whole chunk. They divide it into sections, and there's a section called meta humor, which I was like,
about
"What?
Buttons about buttons?
Buttons about buttons?" And that's a version of what Down with Pants is. Yeah.
You know what's crazy too is that if that's just like pin buttons, there probably is a
buttons
museum.
Buttons, I'm sure
about like.
I don't know where it is, but I'm sure there's a
there's
clothing
probably,
buttons
yeah,
museum
probably,
too.
And I feel like they should combine forces. How the Dakotas
probably,
should as well.
Yeah, of course. Of course they should.
Alrighty, I love you so much. You're the
this
best.
This was so great. Thank you.
All right, follow Angela. Follow the Instagram, and love ya. Bye.